joining us today for his take on the markets, Lawrence Lee of CTS Global Equity Group. Lawrence, great to have you back. Welcome to the program.
Hi, good morning, Mimi. How are you?
Good, good. Congratulations, by the way, for CTS. For
Thank
the
you
listing.
Very much. Appreciate it.
All right. So let's start with a big picture. Philippine stocks saw their best day in over a month yesterday, with the index jumping 1.4% back above 7,100. What's up, literally? And is that even sustainable given the anemic volumes we saw?
Yeah, actually, that's one of the primary concerns that we have in the short term, is because the volumes are really drying up, right? So I really hope that we can get some footing above 7,200. But the reality is more likely we're expecting some semblance of range coming between that 6.9, the 7.2 area in the short term. What I really I'm hoping for is that we find a floor near that 6.9 area, as long as there's a floor, right? Because if you're looking at prices and in terms of valuations in the short term, it seems like the valuations are generally attractive. It's not like we're ridiculously expensive or anything like that. So as long as that there's a floor around that 6.9 level, traders and investors have a place to be able to find some footing to be able to pick up the shares at that level, and hopefully that's something that materializes in the short term. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But in the medium term, though, when you look for the rest of the year, what sort of yield or returns are you expecting from the index?
Yeah, so 7.4, 7.5, I think, is unfortunately the number that we're looking at.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's conservative. That's about 5-8%.
Yeah, I don't want to be too. I don't want to be too bearish. maybe that's the wrong word, but I want to be able to put things into perspective. That you have global yields rising significantly in the short term, right? So you're talking about the U.S. 10-year having spiked significantly over the past 2 to 3 months. You have the Philippine 10-year making its way all the way to 6%. These things are going to put a significant damper on in terms of the liquidity that's going to be present in our markets in the short term. It's one. That means actually, if you're talking about in the U.S., just because of this run-up, you're talking about almost $15 trillion lost in terms of in the bond markets just on this yield rally alone, which is such a significant amount, right? So there's going to be a huge liquidity crunch in the short term. And that's why you're seeing the participants flocking all to the bonds today, right? So an example would be that just a few months ago, if you wanted to get 5-6 year bonds, you'd be getting 2.5 to 3% gross, right? Just the other day, Ali came out with a 6% gross bond that obviously people are all clamoring for. So just to give you an example of what's happening. So how we're attacking it in terms of local markets is that we're trying our best to be able to pick up shares at the most value level. So that's why I'm looking for that floor, right? So as long as there's a floor, the ability for us to pick up shares at those levels and hopefully, rallying towards that 7.273 level, allowing us to take some money off the table there, right? So I do expect ranges moving forward. In terms of runaway in either direction, I think that's going to be muted, right? So hopefully there will be, the U.S. 10-year drops a little bit more, giving some reprieve rally for all of us, right? So until that happens, though, I don't think that you're going to see the market running away significantly in the short term.
This runaway towards either direction, maybe not in the short term, but medium term, what's the inflection point that you think the local market could be waiting for, to break out of this sideways holding pattern? Is it a BSP move finally? Is it peaking inflation, or could it be the elections?
Well, the elections obviously is going to be a coin toss, right? So at this stage, we don't really know what's going to happen there. But more likely, it's going to be the inflation numbers that everyone's really eyeing up. Looking at very closely, you're seeing simple things as food shortage being such a heavy concern. Simple fact that McDonald's has a French fry shortage and today already highlights the significant amount of shortage that we have globally, especially because of this war, right? So that's really putting a lot of an overhang in the short term, right? So if that hopefully gets resolved, we do have a significant ability for us to make our way higher. So hopefully that inflation numbers finally flatten out, and allowing us to be able to, I mean, we've seen this before, right, in the past, right, and eventually that these things do eventually settle themselves out, right? So that's something that hopefully will happen sooner rather than later.
And speaking of inflation, let's go over some interesting corporate stories. The Rice Institute, based in the Philippines, warning that soaring fertilizer costs, even fertilizers are going up, could discourage its use and could lead to, you know, yields contracting by 10% in the next season. This is a loss of about 36 million tons of rice, which could affect, you know, food that's supposed to feed 500 million people this side of the world. And it's not just rice, it's also in sugar. So that's one of the inflation stories we're covering. How about this? BCDA renewing its 20-year lease with Pilipinas Shell for a property along C5 in Taguig City as a full-service mobility station. Pilipinas Shell saying that they're committed to invest 80 to 100 million pesos for improvements and redevelopment of these mobility stations. How are these gasoline, this oil, the oil plays in the Philippines faring at this point?
Well, obviously, that's going to be something that's always going to be highlighted, right? Mm-hmm. So global oil prices have skyrocketed. I'm sure we've all felt the impact of that in the short term, right? Mm-hmm. But it seems like, you know, finally the global supply is finally kicking back in. U.S. Oil and shale, I think that's something that's going to be important, have started to pick up because the prices of oil are attractive enough for them to go full blast in terms of production. So like I said, it's always been something that eventually will settle itself out, where oil prices finally will come down as long as the supply kicks back in. And at this stage, the prices are significantly attractive enough for everybody to go online, right? So this is something that we're watching for very closely. And hopefully because of that, the input costs among all the other things, such as food input costs and production input costs all come down because oil prices eventually flatten themselves out. But I think that in the short term, I think we've seen a peak in terms of the oil prices. And I don't think that there's too much more to go from this point, I hope, right? Unless something drastic happens
on the assumption that oil prices have indeed peaked, will that mean that these oil companies, the oil plays, could see their margins start getting squeezed this year, at least later this year?
I think they have a buffer already, right? So as long as their buffer is in place, I think it should be okay until the rest of the year, right? So I think that the run-up in oil prices gave them enough room to capitalize on it in the short term.
All right. We have this from Jollibee, changing of the guard, at least for CFO position. Ismael Baisa retiring by the end of the month. He's been with Jollibee for close to 20 years. He will be replaced by Richard Chong Wu-Shin, who will take over by May 1st. Baisa is a member of the boards of directors of trustees of Jollibee's other units. He joined Jollibee as CFO back in 2003. Before that, he was VP for Financial Controllership, HR and Corporate Planning for Union Bank. And before that, he was a finance director of Procter & Gamble. He did see, you know, witness a lot of the changes, massive changes, transformational moves by Jollibee, from the purchase of different international brands, restructuring of how the business is doing. What's the condition of Jollibee today that Ismael Baisa leaves behind as he retires soon? You know, Jollibee used to be the darling, one of the more expensive consumer names, and then suddenly the problems just kept propping up. So what's the condition of Jollibee now?
To be honest with you, I'm not overly concerned about Jollibee. They're a fantastic brand, and they know what they're doing, right? So especially with regards to their people and succession planning, they've got this down pat, right? So there might be a little bit of speed bumps down the road in terms of transition, but I think overall, I don't think the vision has really changed for them. Mm-hmm. Really wanting to target being that top 10, top 5 player in terms of food companies globally, right? And I think that's the plan that they put into place, and the one that they're gonna make sure that they'll get done, right? So I think that as long as they're able to make the transition and work on these global brands, Smashburger and CBTL, these last two big names that they've acquired and restructure and do follow through with their plan in terms of the one that they set out on, regardless who's in that position, I think that They've got that one handled pretty well, so I'm not overly concerned about
this. So, Lawrence, you don't think that the golden days are behind Jollibee? Not yet? The best days are still to come?
I think it, in terms of the smooth sailing, where they, in terms of capitalizing on the local consumption, the consumption growth in our country, I think the easy road is over, right? So they're going to have to battle through the rest of the world now, which obviously the playing field is completely different. So I'm not going to put them out of the equation in terms of the capability of getting it done. I just think it's going to be a little more difficult than it was here locally.
All right. From food, let's go to energy. First Gen is donating solar panels to state facilities in the city of Tuguegadao and Cagayan Province. Then you've got an Energy Department and World Bank study showing that the Philippines has the potential to install 21 gigawatts of offshore wind power. How attractive are RE plays at this point, whether valuation-wise or growth potential-wise?
Oh, the last time I was here, the company I think what I was talking about was Aboitiz Power, right? And we're still very, I think all power, not just renewable, right? But I think all power is going to be in heavy demand in the short term, right? So energy shortage has always been a concern for us, and that's not changed this year. So I think all the power companies are always going to be on our radar, and in terms of valuation, they're not expensive by any means, right? So those are the ones we're targeting. We feel like Aboitiz Power, I think, is still attractive at this at these prices, and something that we're looking at very closely in terms of participation.
All right, Aboitiz Power, something to watch out for. Foreign story, Lawrence. Sri Lanka says it officially requested emergency help from the IMF as bailout talks get underway, although that could take at least 6 months. So now they're approaching countries like Japan, China, for example, for a faster release of funds. We did read about Moody's warning that Sri Lanka could see a series of defaults on its foreign debts after officials there said they would halt payments. You know, there's a saying, Lawrence, that when sovereigns borrow, they borrow with no intention of repaying back. They simply plan to roll the loans and pay the interest and go on and on. Are you seeing a risk of more defaults on the horizon? Do you think this is something that's been priced in by the market?
I think everyone's looking at it in the same manner, right? So the spike in the yields, obviously, global yields always is significant concern because borrowing costs are skyrocketing, right? As well as the headwinds in terms, there's so many global headwinds, especially with inflation rising so quickly in the short term, right? So this, I think, is going to be a challenge. I think that I think that the global environment, I think, is still in okay footing. I'm not going to say the best footing, but still at okay footing in terms of defaults, right? There are going to be pockets like Sri Lanka that are going to be obviously going to be in much more trouble than others. But I think for the most part, I think the global markets are in okay footing that they're able to. That's not Russia, by the way, because all of the sanctions are really taking its toll on Russia, right? So there's another news in terms of asking their U.S. public companies to come back to Russia, right? So there's a mandate there. So anything that's not in that part of the world, I think, is an okay footing in the short term. And hopefully that supply kicks in enough, because that's really a ramp up in terms of putting supply into place for all of these, now whether it's oil, whether it's the corn, wheat, rice, all of these guys, they're causing the inflation concerns in the short term, right? So once the supply eventually does kick in, hopefully that the prices eventually normalize and inflation gets itself handled out, right? So until that time, that pressure is going to be on every single nation, right, including us, to be able to manage inflation in the short term.
And manage your debt. We did see a report by Bloomberg. They interviewed the finance chief, Sonny Dominguez, who was quoted as saying, the Philippine economy will need to grow at least 6% more than 6% rather, to be able to cut debt. If not, it's going to be quite a big problem for the next administration, whoever wins, that they're going to inherit. Lawrence, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. I think you like the stock. Don't tell us, just describe. We're going to leave our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have for us this morning?
Yeah, it's, you know, one of the attractive mining companies locally. I think this is something that, especially if you have seen the global commodity itself skyrocket, right? So Indonesian ones have gone like 30-40% higher in the past few weeks. And something that hopefully will trickle down to our local one, right? So I think that the demand for this commodity is really skyrocketing, especially with its use in EVs. And hopefully that this is something that translates in terms of the trickle down to our nation. I don't expect it to go up the same amount as the ones in the foreign ones, but a run up towards that prior high is a significant amount already. So that's something that I'm very excited for, and hopefully materializes in the short term.
Okay, so what sort of upside are you seeing? Because we're showing a one-year price chart. It's looking a bit high, but it has since pulled back from a recent
high there. The 950-10 numbers is a number that I think prices can make its way there, right? So that's another 15-20%. Happy with that, right?
Sounds decent. Thank you very much, Lawrence, for joining us today. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great week ahead.
Have a great week. Thank you for having me.
All right.